good afternoon, and welcome. Welcome on behalf of the Page family. Welcome to all of you who knew and loved Chuck. Welcome to Comox United Church. Whether you are joining us online or here in the sanctuary, it is good to be together and to celebrate Chuck's life, to share tears and laughter. My name is Karen Hollis. I am the minister here at Comox United. We are an affirming congregation, which means no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome and affirmed here. It means whatever emotions you bring today as we remember Chuck, whether that is laughter or delight at stories told, gratitude for his life, or tears at the fact that he has died. Whatever you bring, whatever background you bring with you, whatever you believe or question or wonder about, whatever your faith tradition or no tradition, you are welcome here in this place. As we gather here on the unceded traditional territory of the Comox First Nation, the traditional keepers of this land. All of the hymn lyrics and responses that we're gonna be invited to say together will appear on the screen today for you. If you would like to follow along with the music, if you just like to see the music when you're singing, all the music today can be found in the dark red hymnal, the Voices United hymnal. And just so you know, the washrooms can be found from the lobby to the left and down the ramp. In this service, we also remember that a loving God surrounds us. A spirit that is wider than our imaginations and within each and every one of us. As we begin this time of service, we light the Christ candle to remind us that in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Please join me in prayer. Holy Presence, gifter of life, companion in death, let your peace come and dwell among us. As we open our hearts to you, to grief, to one another, may we have the courage to embrace what we need to feel or not feel, casting no judgment upon ourselves. With respect to the complexity of life, we welcome differences in practices of mourning, and we honor the varied relationships to Chuck present here. Through it all, may we support one another in word, action, and presence. And may the spirit of Chuck be an ongoing teacher and a source of wisdom forever available to us. Amen. I invite us to rise in body and or spirit and sing our first hymn, On Eagle's Wings. If you're following in the hymnal, it's number 808.
Thank you.
You may have noticed the photographs throughout the PowerPoint already. Those photographs were actually taken by Chuck. So that's a nice addition to the PowerPoint. At this time, I'm going to invite Chuck's children, one by one, to come forward and say a few words, beginning with Dan.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dan, and I was Mom and Dad's firstborn. I would like to share with you some memories of my dad. He was a very busy guy. He loved building things. As a boy, he built and flew model airplanes. As a young man, he also built a canoe. In 1983, at age 20, he applied for air traffic control. Around this time, Dad met Mom at a church club in Winnipeg, and Dad was accepted into air traffic control and moved to Regina and started training there. He got his pilot's license as well in Regina and bought an airplane. He qualified as an air traffic controller and then moved to Saskatoon, worked there for a while. Then in December 1955, Mom and Dad got married. In June 1956, they both moved back to Winnipeg as Dad was transferred to Winnipeg Tower. Shortly after, Winnipeg Control was built. It was a center that was built below the control tower. And he moved there and became a center controller. I was born just a year after they married. After starting their family, they moved into a house on Wilton Bay in Winnipeg. When Dad had spare time, he was in the basement building, always building something. He had to sell his airplane due to buying a house. So he changed his interest to sailing, which wasn't quite as expensive. Then he built a catamaran sailboat in the basement of our house. And I really don't know how he managed to get it out of there. But he did, and we went sailing in it. And later, he built a racing sailboat called a Fireball, which Mom and Dad sailed in races on Lake Winnipeg. Lori and Stephen joined the family in 1960 and 1961. It was nice to have playmates. We went camping quite often during the summer and took a trip to BC, camping in a tent all the way. Dad was also a member of the Winnipeg Gliding Club. Still interested in flying, but he didn't own an airplane. One day, he took me up, and I was mesmerized. This was amazing, seeing the ground from up in the sky. This day probably was when the seed was planted, driving me to get my pilot's license and eventually own my own airplane. Both Mom and Dad were swimming instructors. So, of course, all three of us kids had to take swimming lessons. And usually either Mom or Dad would be teaching. Having that training was valuable, being confident and never afraid of the water. In 1966, Dad built a camper trailer out of wood and tent material. He planned it all, he made plans for it, it was incredible. And we took it on vacation to BC, camping all the way. And I remember going through the mountains. We were towing the trailer with a little car called an Austin Mini. I was amazed that it was actually able to pull that thing. And at one point, Dad had to turn on the heat because the engine was overheating. And it was hot outside. The engine temperature immediately came down. I was 9 years old, and I didn't know you could do that. It was a learning moment for me. In 1967, we moved to Jurong Bay in St. James. Dad built a small sailboat called a Sabot, just for us kids. Very simple, with one sail, a centerboard, and rudder. We sailed it a lot and learned a lot about sailing with that little boat. A few summers in a row, we would stay at Spruce Sands Campground on Lake Winnipeg, north of Gimli. Dad would sometimes have to drive into the city to work, but when he had a stretch of days off, he would come up to be with us. I have fond memories of that place, especially when going out to sail in the Sabot. Another fond memory is playing ping pong in our basement rec room. Dad was very good at it, and he did not hold back. He was very difficult to beat. He'd put a wicked spin on the ball, so when you hit it, it would not go where you intended it to go. I became pretty good at it, occasionally beating Dad, after learning how to incorporate that spin. Dad was also interested in photography and built a dark room where he would develop pictures he took. He taught me how to do it, and for a while I was very interested in photography as well and did quite a bit of developing myself with all the chemicals and whatnot. He continued with photography all the way into his 80s. Dad was also involved in the scuba diving club, and at one time he was building something involving a small compressor. "What are you building?" I said. "Oh, it's a compressor that I will use to recharge the scuba tanks." "Wow," I thought, "that is very ingenious." Regarding sailing again, Dad decided he wanted a sailboat the whole family could fit in and sleep in. So he bought an old wooden cruising sailboat called the Egret. We sailed it on a multi-day race on Lake of the Woods, and it was a bit leaky and wet inside, but we managed to finish the race. And then Dad decided the boat needed a new hull, so he did some research and settled on building a cement hall. Yes, I said cement. He got it built and refurbished the inside. Dad was also interested in investing and was quite good at picking winning stocks. And when computers came along, he wrote his own program to time buys and sells. Dad taught me about investing, and I'm still doing it to this day. He also got involved with computers at work when they computerized the radar system, taking courses and eventually becoming what they call a data systems controller. He was the guy in charge of monitoring the computer system that drives the radars. Both Mom and Dad were also involved in ballroom dancing and actually started a club in St. James that is still active today. Keep in mind, while Dad was doing all this building, he was also working full-time, plus lots of overtime and shift work. I'm still amazed at how much he accomplished during his life. We moved to Clandeboy in 1973, with Dad commuting to work. I was driving by this time and interested in cars. I bought an old Mercury Meteor that needed a new engine. So Dad and I installed a newer engine in it. It was a good bonding experience with Dad. Later, I helped him replace the engine in his station wagon. Then Dad decided he wanted to sell sailboats and started Interlake Sail Incorporated. He sold a few Tanzer sailboats and also stored several other people's boats on our acreage. Dad had so many interests and accomplishments, it's hard to remember them all. There is so much more, but I'll stop here and just say, Dad, you are a great role model, and I love you for really helping me prepare for life as an adult. Thanks, Dad. And Stephen, I believe, will be next.
Good afternoon, everybody. As you heard, I'm Steve, the youngest child, here to talk about my dad a little bit. So when people close to us die, we often have regrets because maybe we didn't tell them how we appreciated them and everything they did for us, or we didn't tell them how often we loved them. I think my dad knew, even though I didn't tell him, that I appreciated everything he did and that I loved him. I do want to take this opportunity while I'm up here to say to my mom, who's still very much with us, that I think you're an amazing person and I appreciate everything you've done for the family and I love you very much. Okay, now on to my dad. When I heard about my dad passing, I was sad for a while, but then I realized we all have to go at some time. We don't get to choose how we're born. We don't usually get to choose how we die, but we definitely get to choose how we live. And I think my dad did a pretty good job there. And for that, I am happy. I'm happy that he got to fulfill his dreams, have amazing adventures, get married, and have a family. And I'm especially happy that his end did not involve a prolonged illness or stay in the hospital. So today we are here to celebrate my dad's amazing life. My dad was an amazing person. He was the ultimate do-it-yourselfer. All the time I was living in my parents' house, I don't ever remember a service person coming in to fix anything. Never. If an appliance was broken, there were two options: fix it ourselves or throw it out and buy a new one. My dad was pretty good when it came to fixing things. But on occasion, things would be put aside to fix later on, sometimes much later on. And then my mom would have to step in and say, "Chuck, I don't think you're going to be able to fix that." And my dad would eventually agree, but not before giving it his all. When my dad needed or wanted something, the first option was build it yourself. And he was pretty good at that, too. He built a canoe, a sailboats, a surfboard, a camper trailer. And after we moved out of the city into Clandeboy, he took on a tremendous challenge, building an addition onto our house. And this was no small addition. Nothing my dad did was ever small. We basically doubled the size of our house. We built a huge double garage with bedrooms on top, an ensuite, and a second bathroom. And this was a huge undertaking, and the whole family worked on it. I remember digging holes for the concrete piles by hand, digging out the foundation by hand, mixing and pouring the cement with a little electric cement mixer. And at the time, I never thought, why can't we hire someone to do this? It was just another building project that Dad wanted to do, and he needed our help. One year, Dad surprised me with a beautiful Christmas present. It was a huge cart full of blocks, wooden blocks. There must have been over 100. They came in 5 or 6 different sizes, but they were all made from 3/4-inch hardwood, and they were all painted different colors. There were small pink blocks, about 3 by 3 inches, and there were red blocks and blue blocks, and they were all multiples of that 3 by 3 inch size. My brother and sister and I played with those blocks endlessly. We built structures, we made dominoes, and we knocked the dominoes down and we put them back up again. And even putting the blocks away in the cart was fun, trying to find the most efficient way to lay them in the cart. At the time, I assumed my dad made those blocks, but I never thought about how much effort it would have taken. Each block was perfectly formed, true right angles, smooth, sanded edges. The paint job was impeccable. Now that I have experience with woodworking, I realized that this wasn't just something that took a few days. It must have taken him weeks to build those blocks. I don't know where he found the time to make those blocks, but he did. My dad was pretty economical, but every once in a while he would surprise the family with a new fancy gadget, and it was usually the latest technology. I remember him coming home and surprising the family with things like a color TV, a dishwasher, a snowblower, even a tractor. One day he came home with something in a big, heavy cardboard box. He said something he called a microwave oven. I'd never heard of a microwave oven, but he said it was the latest cooking technology and that it would, you know, revolutionize the world. So my dad was an early adopter of computers, and this was in the late 70s when computers were just being implemented in the workplace, and the first personal computers were becoming available. At work in air traffic control, he took courses to become the one guy who knew how to boot the air traffic controller's computer. And this changed his life because it allowed him to work a day job instead of shift work. It also changed the lives of my brother and sister and I because now we didn't have to be quiet during the day or in the evening when he was sleeping. One day, my dad bought me a computer for my birthday. It was a Radio Shack color computer. It had 16K of memory. I spent a lot of my spare time on this computer, learning how to program in BASIC, creating games, and writing useful software. My dad was really into sailing. It was his greatest pastime. In the mid-70s, he started a company called Interlake Sail, selling keelboats and smaller sailboats. This allowed him to fund his love of sailing. He always kept a keelboat at Gimli Harbor on Lake Winnipeg. There, he could demonstrate boats to prospective buyers. He could teach people sailing. And when he wasn't doing that, he could go out on the keelboat, keelboat races and cruise the lake. It was his passion. I learned to sail with my dad, and I learned to sail in a lot of races with my dad. Those were good times. I remember one day there was an issue with the rigging on the boat up at the top of the mast. The only way to fix it was to winch someone up to the top of the mast, so I volunteered. I was the lightest. We had a bosun's chair, which is basically a swing seat with wires connected to it. So I sat down in the bosun's chair, and the wire was connected to the halyard, which goes up to the top of the mast, and came back down again to a winch. And my dad winched me up to the top of that mast. That was really scary. Scary because I was so high. And the only thing keeping me from a 30-foot fall to the deck was my dad's firm grip on the rope. But I managed to fix the rigging, and my dad lowered me to safety to the ground. Whew. When I look back at my life and what I've accomplished, what I enjoy doing, and what I've passed on to my children, much of it comes from my dad and my early childhood. Building with blocks gave me an understanding of perspective and being able to visualize in three dimensions. Seeing him take things apart and put them back together again gave me an understanding of how things are built and gave me the confidence to disassemble and rebuild and to know it was okay to fail sometimes, as long as you learn something from the experience. These attributes led me to a successful career in engineering. His interest in computing sparked my own interest in computing and programming, and that's been instrumental in my work and has been passed down to my son, who's now a successful computer programmer. My dad's love of sailing has been passed down two generations. My family has several sailboats, and my family and I will often go out for a sail at our cottage on Lake Manitoba. And his big home renovation, that gave me the confidence to do a renovation of our own home, where we more than doubled the square footage of our house. And my kids are also into home renovation. My eldest daughter is working on buying, renovating, and reselling her third house, and while she's raising a family and working full time. And my youngest daughter has started renovating with her first house with her fiancé. So I have to say, Dad, congratulations. You did it. You had a great life. You lived your dreams. And you passed on your skill and your passion to your future generations. Well done. Well done, Dad. Thank you.
I'm the middle child. I'm going to give that microphone a rest and let this one work for a bit. And I want us to start saying how good it is to see you all here, and I want to thank you on behalf of my brothers and myself for looking after my mom and dad all these years, and particularly for your support for my mom at this time. She's not a person that asked for a lot of help, but she has so appreciated all of your tenderness and kindnesses. So thank you for that, all of you. So I'm going to talk a little bit about after my mom and dad retired and moved to Courtney to be with you. And they had a lot of time then for new adventures. And they went south in their RV, they went sailing, and they went camping. They took some cruises once in a while. They joined this church, various clubs. And if there wasn't a club, they started it. Because, you know, just because you're retired doesn't mean you're not still doing all the stuff all the time. So computer club, camera club, dancing group, they were still in the thick of everything going on. Those were good years. And as dad got older, he had more and more health issues. There was less ability to travel, and he ended up being less able to be physically adventurous, but he was still mentally adventurous. He always took a lot of pleasure in being outside, and he was always very observant. Like he noticed all kinds of stuff, you know, what was in the sky, what was on the water, every little flower. He was paying attention, and so it was natural that he immersed himself in photography. Flowers and birds and the Puntland River kayakers were often subjects. He always had projects on the go. He took his photography and his computer skills, and he did everything new. Like the number of different ways of framing a photograph that I never had any idea of, well, he was doing all that. And even as he became more frail, he was still walking down to the river every chance he got. And in his later years, he got also kind of philosophical. Or maybe he was always philosophical and he didn't say it to me, I don't know. But he did things like he fell in love with a cat, he faced the idea of death, and he got all his affairs in order. He mused about God and the universe, and he wrote some poetry. And I'm going to read a few excerpts of the poetry, but I just want to say, I think if you had to kind of sum up who Dad was and how he lived, it would be prepare for the future, but live for today. And because he did both of those things, and he did it by building stuff himself, or like there was no obstacles to, if he wanted to do something, he figured out how to do it, but he still prepared for the future. So here's a little bit of poetry. I bet you did. How many of you knew my dad did poetry? You know, this is going to be new, right? Like a few people. Here you go. All right. Do you watch the summer's night sky with comets and meteors flashing by, or know the thunder and light of a storm's great might whirling through the darkest night? Have you heard the meadowlark's song telling the story of God's daybreak glory, or seen flying the great bald eagle from trees so tall in the first breath of fall? Have you touched spring's trillium carpet all over the forest floor, or felt love's warm embrace? Can there really be that much more? God's there, you know, in the darkest night, the misty morn, and the eagle's flight. Prayer's been answered, thought's been heard. God's here, you know, just a heartbeat away, only a breath beyond, a mere thought apart. I walk the beach in wave-tossed foam and wonder, perhaps, can this be your earthly home? Then you wave to me, flying on by, a whisper white cloud in a bright blue sky. In the dark of night, when I've lost a light, you take my hand, and off we go to unnamed land to dream on a thought, sing with a bird, or ride on a cloud. No more alone, I am a part of what there is, of what has been, of what's to be. You guide me there. My God, hear my prayer. For this place, for Earth, I care. Thanks, folks. Mom. I was going to read, we received two letters from two people named Ken that were friends of Chuck. Very good friends from high school days. Now this is from Ken Shipley. I was sorry to learn about Chuck's death. He and I were good friends during our high school years in Winnipeg. We both lived in the West End and got together many times over those years. At one point, he bought a Durant car. I don't remember exactly, but it would have been about a 1930 model. It was 1928. Grand Beach was one of our favorite places to go. We both liked the beach, although Chuck was a better swimmer than I was. I remember one unseasonably hot 24th of May weekend when we and a couple of girls made the trip, probably in the Durant. The day was hot, but the water was really cold. I think Lake Winnipeg was still frozen a mile or two up the lake. Chuck and I were quite chagrined that the girls could stand the cold water better than we could. We were both pretty skinny then. At least that was our excuse. Later, he got his pilot's license and bought a Piper Cub aircraft. I remember flying with him from Winnipeg to Dauphin. Now, why did he want to go there? Did the fact that you were a Dauphin girl have something to do with it? Finally, I want to thank you for the loving care you gave him in the last few years. I think of you both fondly. This is from Ken Sanderson. I met Chuck when I moved to Winnipeg from rural Manitoba in 1951. We met initially through the Young People's Union at Chalmers United Church, where we later also met Barb. But our homes were close to each other, and we met often and had many adventures together. We swam in the lakes around Winnipeg, often together with Ken Shipley. With me, he visited my home in Holland, Manitoba, sometimes traveling there on his motorcycle and sometimes in his favorite car. We made a bet at that time. I bet that I would greatly improve my golf course and golf in the 80s. He bet that he would build and fly his own glider. I made no progress on my golf game. To my knowledge, he did not do exactly what he hoped to do, but he did learn to fly an airplane, bought and flew his own airplane, and learned to work as an air traffic controller. So he came a lot closer than I did to achieving his goal, and can be said to have won the bet. I had the great pleasure and honor of being best man at the wedding of Chuck and Barb in Dauphin in 1955. Then I left Manitoba in the late 1950s. Since then, we have always kept in touch, but have not seen each other as often. Many years ago, he and Barb came to Calgary to sail on the Glenmore Reservoir and stayed with my wife Elaine and myself. In 2010, we visited them in Courtney. We had a wonderful visit and dinner with them and a walk on the nearby mountains. Life has not been easy for Chuck in the last 8 years, but I will always remember the cheerful, gregarious, and interesting person he was, and I am grateful for having known him. We will all miss him. Many thanks to Barb for helping to keep us in touch during the last years. Ken Sanderson.
The scripture reading is taken from the New International Version of the Bible, Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
I didn't have the pleasure of meeting Chuck, but what a life. And the stories just keep coming. God may have been the only one who was able to keep up, supporting Chuck in his own natural and unique rhythm of life. As I read and reread this short passage that Barb chose for this occasion, I wondered about God's right hand. Why the right hand? The right hand. Why did Isaiah express it in that way? Well, the text assumes that one is facing east, the direction of the rising sun, the dawn of a new day, the possibilities open to us. When facing the east, the west is at one's back. This is known as the anchor. This is the direction of grounding, while the east is the potential and the promise. The west is what has taken place, the rooting and grounding that we receive from where we have been and who we have become. To the right hand, is the direction where the sun is highest in the sky, the direction of strength and righteousness, being fully embodied and engaged in life. We complete the circle with the north, the direction where the sun does not appear in the sky. The north is the direction of what is veiled and mysterious, that which is only available, for instance, through the lens of a camera, or known beneath the surface of the water. Standing with our faces to the rising sun, or perhaps in Chuck's case, running toward a new day, all of this is available to us. As Chuck explored the fullness of what life on earth, air, and sea had to offer, he knew that God was with him. And perhaps that knowledge gave him the courage he needed in some moments. Any of us, when finding ourselves without our feet on the floor or ground, or double checking that the anchor will hold, or relying on this instrumentation to ensure people's safety, or listening for the lines of a poem, might reach to the right and left for the mystery and the strength of God to guide us. Perhaps also in seasons of grief, in moments of calm and drifting, in memories, in joy and laughter, in gritty moments, in impossible moments, where we don't necessarily even want to turn toward the sun, God is with us, steadfast as always. God meets us with whatever we need in the moment, the anchor or grounding, possibilities, that which is present yet not quite known, the strength to lift us up when we have none. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us now enter into a time of prayer. I invite us to take a few breaths to bring ourselves into the present moment. As you breathe, perhaps you want to find your feet on the floor or feel the support of the seat underneath you. Please join me in the yellow portions of the prayer, or bolded in your printed bulletin. God of grace and glory, we thank you for Chuck, who was so near and dear to us, and who has now passed on. We thank you for the friendship he gave us, and for the joy and laughter he brought. We thank you for the love he offered and received while he was with us on earth. We pray that nothing good in Chuck's life will be lost, but will be a benefit to the world, that all that was important to him will be respected by those who follow, and that everything in which he was great will continue to mean much to us now. We ask that he may go on living in his children and grandchildren, his family and his friends, in our hearts and in our living. Loving God, we pray that we do not try to minimize this loss or seek refuge from it in words alone, and that we do not brood over it so that it overwhelms us and isolates us from others. Help us to turn toward each other in our grief so that we do not have to walk with it alone. We are grateful that you are with us. And in the mystery of all that we cannot see, we pray that Chuck is with us too, and that we might continue to catch glimpses of him in the world. Amen. Let us continue in prayer in the way Jesus taught us, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The poem is called Gone From My Sight by Henry Dyke. I am standing upon the seashore. A ship at my side spreads her white sails to the moving breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud just where the sea and sky come to mingle with each other. And then someone at my side says, there, she's gone.
Gone where?
Gone from my sight, that is all. She's just as large in mast, hull, and spar as she was when she left my side. And she is just as able to bear her load of living freight to her destined port. Her diminished size is in me, not in her.
And just at the moment when someone says, there she is gone, there are other eyes watching her coming and other voices ready to take up the glad shot. Here she comes.
And that is dying.
I feel alone.
No, stay. Stay standing is the right thing for the moment. Let us now commend our loved one, Chuck, into God's eternal care. You are welcome to raise a hand in blessing or maybe put a hand over your heart, whatever fits for you in this moment. Please join me on the bolded yellow portions. Into the freedom of the wind and the sunshine, Chuck, we let you go. Into the tears and laughter of our memories, we commend you. Into the dance of the stars and the planets, we release you. Into the cycle of living and dying and rising again, you take your place. Chuck, you have been loved and continue to be loved. You will be missed. May you rest in peace and joy. May you run straight home to God's embrace. As we turn to depart from this place, receive this blessing. May the memories of Chuck be your companion. May they bring laughter and joy when your heart is heavy. May they bring strength when the days are long. May they be a reminder of the gifts of life, so precious and short. On this day, on all the days before us, may the profound love of God be your companion through all things. Go in peace, beloveds. God's love goes with you. Amen.